Hello and welcome back to another Cheat Engine tutorial. Today we're going to take a look at the memory viewer. You can do lots of fun little tricks with it. One of the best ways to demonstrate it is by using some kind of small game, like an 8-bit game. Because an 8-bit game will have a small memory footprint. So most of the values will be pretty close together. So for this reason, I've got the Genesis emulator ready here. And we're going to do some hacking on Ghouls and Ghosts. Of course, Ghouls and Ghosts, the version I'm using was a release for the 16-bit Mega Drive or Genesis. But the game internally is just an 8-bit game. So let's start it up. And my cheat engine is already matched to the emulator. Oh, and we don't have any video. Okay. That's an annoying bug of Fusion. Let's just reload it. And here we go. So let's just start a game. Okay, one of the first things to really use the memory viewer is, well, you gotta find the memory of the game. And of course this game is also surrounded by a whole lot of memory from the, well, the emulator itself. Well, let's start off with a value that's pretty easy to find and that we have a lot of control over, and that is the score. So right now we're at 0 and we only have to kill an enemy to increase the score. Okay, so this score is already at 100, and let's open a notepad here because this is a 8-bit game. The maximum value that we can find, or that a single byte can store, is 256. So this player score is going to rapidly go over the 256 value. We're already at 200. But here is a little trick. The last zero is actually not part of the value. Our actual value is just 20. So let's switch our cheat engine to byte and let's search for a value of 20. Now we just need to kill another enemy. We're already at 30. And there you have it. So this is our score. We can just, let's say, double it to 60. And this should show 600 now. There it is. That means that we now have a nice entry to browse the memory region. So let's see what we can mess with in the memory. I'll have to make it smaller. Okay, first things first. We want to configure the view on the memory. We know it's a 8-bit game. So we just right-click and go to display type, and we go to a single byte decimal. Because 8-bit game is just 1 byte, 16-bit game, 2 bytes, etc. So we switch to the new view, and we see that here in the upper left is our score, 60. Now, say we want to have no time limit. Okay, this time is also constructed in a kind of weird way. The first part of the time is just an integer, which means it's just a 1 or a 2 in memory. And let's see if we can, just by standing here, see what's going on in the memory. See if we can detect some kind of a timer looping. So I'm going to unpause the game. Okay, we don't see a lot of stuff happening here, so let's scroll a bit up. In the meantime, I'll have to be careful. Okay, nothing's happening there. Let's scroll. There's not a lot of values here. Maybe we should start scrolling down more. In the meantime, I'll have to be careful that I don't get killed. Okay, there's definitely some kind of timer looping around over here. Oh, I got... Okay, let's see what happens if we start messing with this address right here. We'll just add it to our cheat engine table. Let's try locking it. Okay, that's not affecting our time, so that's not what we're looking for. Oh, and we died. Alright, let's see. So that value was of no use to us. Let's try scrolling up a bit. Okay, here is another value that seems to be looping around. And not only that, with every quick loop of this, it's affecting this value right over here. So this looks to be like a kind of a millisecond timer. It's going quickly from, I think, between 0 and 60. And every time it completes a trip, it starts, I think, decreasing or increasing this value over there. Let's take another look. Okay, so this value over here is counting down. So this is probably our time value. And then this one over here is the 1 minute over here. So what we can do is, let's add this address to the list as well. We'll just add the complete timer construction. Let's call this minutes. Then this will be the seconds. So these are the two values that we see on screen. But this one over here is the, I think, the millisecond, which is just internally counting very quickly. And once it loops, it starts increasing or decreasing the seconds. Now let's see what happens. All right, so one other weird detail here is this 73 does not match 49. But if we go into the calculator, and I'm using the programmer calculator right here, we can see if there's maybe a kind of a hex decimal conversion going on. So if I type, let's say, a decimal 73, that we see in memory, yeah, then we can see that the hex value of 73 is actually 49. So for some reason, the value being shown here is actually the hexadecimal value and not the decimal value that it's using internally. All right, so well, then we found the time. We can just lock these values. And now we have an unlimited time in the game. Okay, so now that we have unlimited time, we can take a bit more time, of course, trying out some other cheats. Let's see if we can somehow make ourselves invulnerable. For that, I'm just going to die. So we'll have a good starting position. Okay, well, this is our starting position. And now let's make a save state. We'll just save this in a new slot. There we go. Save states are a very powerful tool to quickly switch between states of memory. So we want to detect what's happening with our armor. Because we get hit, we lose our armor. There's a couple ways we could do this. We could try just a new scan for an unknown value and then constantly reload our states and save our states and see which part of the memory gets changed once we take a hit. But we could also again just try browsing the memory. And we've got two starting points into memory now. We've got the minutes or the time part, and we've got our score part. And I believe this was a value that we thought was the time, but that wasn't it. So let's just get rid of that one. We'll call this score. Okay, let's see if we can get hit. And we'll make a save state a bit before we get hit. Okay, we see. Now we just have to reload with F8. And every time we press F8, we see the new situation in memory appear. So let's see, we're scrolling a bit down here. Something that we notice over here, these values, a 0, a 1, and a 1. If we load our game, it's a 1 and a 2. And a whole bunch of stuff around it changes as well. Okay, so let's try adding these addresses to our list and see in what way they affect our game. Because we're looking for pretty simple values. I'm thinking like being half naked could be like a 1 or a 0. Having an armor could be a higher value. And then having the super armor will be even a higher value than that. So let's see what happens if we reload here. It's 112, now it's 011. Oh wait, I somehow selected a different save slot through the keyboard. Let's get back to 5. Okay, let's load the game, quickly pause it. This time we're locking these values. Okay, so our hunch is correct. These are the values that are keeping our armor on. So basically, we're now invulnerable. But of course, there's also the super armor. We could try just messing with these values now. Let's say we make this 2 a 3, for example. Well, now that we jump, we get the super armor. But we don't have the super armor powers. Because usually there will be a little energy bar here that will fill up and allow us to use our super special weapon power. So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to switch this back to 2. And we're just going to get back into the normal armor. And we're going to try and find the super armor and see what changes in memory. So we're back to our regular playthrough now. And there should be a super armor somewhere around, I believe, over this next hill. Okay, so there's the super armor. Let's just make a save state here. And now we can take another look in memory and see what's going on. What kind of values are changing when we pick up the armor. Okay, so we see that these values that we just stored in memory, they went 1, 2, 3. Okay, let's reload the state. Let's see what happens if we now manually change these values to 1, 2, 3. Okay, but we still don't have the power. Okay, let's take another look at memory. Okay, let's do it. Quick reload. I see this 0 over here is changing to a 5. Let's see what else is happening. OK, Okay, when we move, a lot of values change as well, which is kind of distracting. But we really have to keep an eye out for the things that are actually changing when we pick up the armor. Okay, so I think this value here is also changing to from a 0 to a 1. Let's add it to the list. No, it actually just stays 1. Okay, yeah, that value stays 1. This is still going to change from 1 to 3. Okay, maybe it's somewhere in another part of memory. Let's quickly just look around. Yeah, I don't see much interesting. Most of it is empty. Let's see if we can scroll a bit down here. Okay, this one quickly changes from a 3 to a 2, but I don't think that's what we are looking for either. Okay, let's watch this 0 over here. See how it changes to a 1? Let's add this value to our list. Okay, so what happens if we change this back to a 0, what we started with? Or we change it to a 1 right here. Hey! Okay, so this bar just popped up. So we didn't actually pick up the super armor. We only changed this value over here from a 0 to a 1. And apparently that's a separate switch that gets triggered when we pick up the armor, which activates our super armor powers. So now I should be able to just power up my weapon. And it actually also shows the super armor when doing the power. But we're not using the actual armor. So these values over here, these are now combined the super armor. So we could probably, let's see, let's pick up the armor. And we can basically just lock all these values, get hit, and we'll still have all the powers. Alright, so there you have it. We've got basically unlimited health in a way. Well, unlimited hits. We have no time limit. And, well, we can manipulate our score, but that's not really useful for any playthrough. Using the same way with the memory, just memory browsing and the switching of the save states. You could also probably detect where your weapon is being stored. Although that's probably a bit more involved. I tried it earlier. You can find the switch for the weapon. But the graphics also take a big part in memory that gets changed. So you can change the memory and change your weapon. But the graphics will get a bit glitchy, because there's a lot of other memory values that need to be changed with it. But that's something fun that you could try out for yourself. And with that, that's the end of this little tutorial. Thanks for watching.